Hello viewers, welcome to our program on immigration and you. I am your immigration attorney Michael Fulwani, and with me again is my law partner David Nachman. David, welcome.
Thanks so much, Michael, and once again to all our viewers, happy new year and welcome back.
Same from me too, and we are already in the new year. 2015 is going to be a very, very lucky, very, very important year. Lot of changes, whether by way of executive action or hopefully the comprehensive immigration reform bill may happen. So, God willing, inshallah, we see. Okay, so today's program, we're going to talk about, we did talk about DACA, we talked about DAPA, but we did not explain to them about getting ready, prepared for that.
Right. What documents they need?
What kind of documentation they need? Quickly, I want to say, basically, you have to look at the requirements of each of the program. Mm-hmm. For example, the entry in the U.S., like children have to be coming under the age of 16, so they have to prove that.
Right.
There's a residency requirement, which is now from 2010 to 2015, that had to
exactly.
be put. In some cases, you have to also show the knowledge of English language.
Right.
And you have to make sure that either you have a deportation or a deportation order that has to be dealt with
right.
separately.
Exactly.
But when you look at these, you can have your own idea anyway. But I can just very, very quickly run and then David can. Basically, we need the birth certificates, school records, medical records, pay stubs and driver's license. Anyway, basically think about that. Think about your children, what they do. For example, right. the sports, talk to the teacher, and any incidents might have happened. You got married, somebody got married, you went and attended that. Some person gave birth to a child in a such and such year. So
yeah.
what I did in 1986 when President Reagan's time, they had this amnesty law, I told them that take a folder. I did year by year, and they can do month by month. Take 1 year, 2009, 10, 11, each folder.
Mm-hmm.
See what you can find on these ideas. And put in separate, make a whole list. Easy for you, easy for the lawyers who will be preparing your case as well. And easy
exactly.
for the government to understand.
Exactly.
Believe me, in my cases at that time, when it was so, they were getting surprised that every folder, every year's details, dates and date, the whole summary in each year. So it was fantastic. So it's spent a lot of time though. But give us some more detailed information about what kind of documents you think they should be looking and getting ready and which other way can be prepared.
Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask actually that a slide be shown on the screen, which is a really nice explanation about what documents the individuals can get together. But I think I'm going to give some, because it's on the screen, I'm going to let you go ahead and read each of those points. But I'm going to tell you some very practical things, which I think are a lot more interesting to our viewers. Obviously, it tells you what types of documents. But number one is, if you would like more detailed information about DAPA and about the documents that we're sending, you know, we're telling our clients to get together, please feel free to send me an email at david_Nachman@visaserve.com or to info@visaserve.com or to michael_Fulwani@visaserve.com. And we will provide you, we have a list of documents, we have a white paper on the program, and we are more than happy to provide this as a service to the community for free. There's no charge. We will send it to you. We will send you this information. And you'll have it then, and you can just follow it as a nice little checklist. So we are more than happy to do that. All you have to do is send us a request.
And if you decide to go forward and come for a consultation from our law firm.
Yeah, you're welcome to do that, of course.
You need to call, make an appointment, and then we can discuss more. Bring
exactly,
those papers.
Because there are nuances, of
and
course.
And bring those papers, we can take a look at
exactly.
them, give you further guidance, further suggestions, and help you.
Exactly. Now, I think that one of the things, as you can see, I'm sure that many people are looking at that slide and copiously making notes. Don't feel that you have to make those notes now. Just send us an email and we'll be happy to provide that slide to you. So you'll have that list. So don't worry about it. But more importantly, I think if you can come back to my face on the camera. More importantly, I'd like to tell you about a couple of practical aspects because I want to share some stories. Number one, for $30 or so, go over to an office place and pick up a safe and put your documents into a safe, because I have heard horror stories about documents getting lost. If there's a storm, documents getting drowned. Believe it or not, I know a person who lost their documents because their dog ate it. I thought that only happened to homework. But here's the thing. Keep your documents safe. These documents are very important because they are documents that are going to be able to prove your ability to get the benefits. Some of you might not have these documents, and that doesn't, here's the thing. Some of you may have submitted documents many years ago to the government, or the government may have those documents. There's something called a FOIA request. Please feel free to reach out for your lawyers. We are more than happy to help you to do a FOIA request to the government to get the documents that the government has. You may have submitted documents before, and you may not have kept copies. We're more than happy to help you to get those. So those are just a couple of practical aspects of, you know, aggregating your documents for the benefits. And so anything, of course, that we can do, we're more than happy to do it. Again, it's our hope that as many people as possible will be able to take advantage of this program.
And there are a lot of small things. People don't think about that. Think. Close your eyes and think about what
exactly.
You can do. For example, you went to a dentist. In the year 2008.
Exactly.
You go to the record.
You have a medical record.
Medical records.
That's right.
Whichever way.
It means
records.
You were here.
You went to a cousin's marriage in Chicago, for example.
Exactly. Maybe you have
pictures. Were taken. Invitation card. Exactly. Kankotri is there.
Exactly.
So think, child was born, or you got married to somebody. You had a boyfriend and a girlfriend who can give an affidavit.
Exactly.
For so many years you've been together, going around, dinners and all that. Right? You can just don't get no more details about that. But basic ones.
Right.
So think, be innovative, be creative, and
exactly.
It will work out. Now, as you said, you don't have to, because if we send you a list of 90 items, it doesn't mean that you should have all of them.
Exactly, and that's something that a lot of people have to understand. It's an issue of interpolation.
Keep on calling, David, but I don't have this. David, but Michael, I don't have that.
Exactly.
I don't have this. Whatever you have, we cannot, you know, create anything now if they're not there.
Well, I think that, Michael, that's a great point, and thank you very much for making it, because a lot of people think when they get a list that they have to have every single document
exactly.
on the list.
Right.
It's really like it was in DACA, it was about what's called interpolation. And interpolation, for many of you mathematicians, know that it's about trying to figure out, based on documents around a certain date, that the individual was there on a particular date. So if let's say you have documents from May and July, then there's an assumption that you were also here in June. So we, again, that's really, Michael, that's where we, or your, obviously your lawyers, can help you to understand what it is you need to get together to create a good, solid case. Now, obviously, everything we're saying pens getting the FAQs and seeing what the FAQs say.
It reminds me of my past when one of the clients didn't have nothing much. But I kept on saying, but your family's in India, don't you write each other? At that time, there were no emails. So, yeah. So he brought a lot of letters and cards that came from his family in India
right.
with a postage stamp
and address to his house.
Address
right? yeah,
and stamp dates exactly. stamps on each of the envelope.
Exactly.
Okay. Then I said, but do you send some money to family there? Say, yeah, yeah. I send them $500 or $400 every
so
month.
They have the records.
So how did you send the money orders? Are they through the bank? Whatever right. the dish receives.
MoneyGrams. Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
Like
exactly.
that. So many small things. Just think.
Right.
Who has said I have nothing? We said, I have nothing. We submitted all the letters. We submitted, officer happy, boom.
Exactly. So we've seen clients who have come in to talk to us already about taking advantage of DAPA and the DACA extension who are incredibly organized and have documents going way back. But there's some who are not. And so I think it's very important for those of you who are not, probably there's even a more immediate need for you to begin to make plans to start to get the documents together, because you're going to have to go out to third parties and to possibly get those documents. So now is not too early to start planning to get the documentation together.
It's understandable. A lot of clients say, listen, I'm illegally here. I don't have a social security number. I don't have a bank account. I don't have a driver license.
Right.
I was just hiding and just working and making some money and living my life. So it's all the more we have this, more important to go more into the depth to see what else can we dig out. Because I understand the problems of many people who don't have anything. They were quietly came in illegally. They never got into any of this documentation.
Exactly.
They have,
well, there was always a fear. There was always a fear. And
exactly.
So that's why they didn't do it. Michael, let's change
the
subject. What's the future?
Future.
Let's talk about the future.
Okay.
And so we have a slide actually on what potentially the future holds. And of course, for those of you who are following what's going on with President Obama's announcements, you know that in Congress, actually in the House of Representatives before the end of the year. There was a bill proposed to block the president's actions and to deem them to be unconstitutional. And that, of course, was a very interesting idea. But what it also did is it showed that the individual who proposed that didn't really understand what the president was doing, because I don't think you get a lot of mileage out of something like that. I think that even in that bill, there was reference to executive action, which is not what this was. It was administrative relief. Yeah. So I think that that probably goes nowhere fast. But there was also about 18 states that filed a lawsuit to enjoin the president's actions. And that, of course, is still pending, although Western District of Pennsylvania, back in mid-December, determined that the president's executive administrative relief, executive announcements, were unconstitutional. Do you want to talk a little bit about that, Michael?
This is very recently, about 4 or 5 days ago. This is not a challenging to the law. This action was in connection with the person from Guatemala who was in deportation and had been deported. He headed back home.
Right.
And when this executive order comes in, he applied that he should be permitted to re-enter based upon these provisions in the law. So, of course, it was not accepted, denied anyway, because that did not follow exactly within the executive action or the reliefs. But I don't know why judge then went back to this issue. He went into the issue of validity or constitutionality of this thing. And he said, by the way, like it's a side note here in which he had a separate memo, that this is not valid, this is unconstitutional. And right. President Obama did not have the authority to do this.
Right, well, it was because it was in Western Pennsylvania, which is extremely conservative, of course.
I'm not much worried about that, but let's talk more. I mean, worried about other things also, not just that particular order, which is really not a binding or not even a decision based upon a challengeability. That's opinion, by the way, opinion.
Yeah, of course. Well, let's just bring that slide back up about what the future holds. And then, of course, there's a possibility that, as we know, the budget passed, but it was interesting that the budget only pays for the USCIS, the Department of Homeland Security, through February. So that's to be determined.
But
we'll have to find out.
On a budget. Yeah? In some way, I thought that budget means that they were saying the government will shut down and they're not going to accept it. So in one way, they were able to sit down and there was some kind of coordination between bipartisan, making it a bipartisan bill to get it passed.
Right, well, it shows that,
that
it works.
Maybe that state of our mind may help also in a CIR getting passed, because, listen, the Senate has already passed the Comprehensive Immigration Reform Bill. In the House, it is still pending now. They can go forward and vote that, and it's not very likely to happen between you and me and the public. But this, who knows? They work out with some changes that are acceptable to both.
Well, remember now that the now we have a Republican Senate, we have a Republican House, and so probably what's going to end up happening is that prior bill, Senate S-744, is probably going to end up being tabled, and what will end up happening is we'll see a new bill coming out of the Senate, which then, of course, will be dealt with by the House in markup. We have no idea what'll happen with that, but that'll be offered up to the president, and we'll see. The president may either veto it or he may sign it, so we'll have to see what happens.
Well, I think all depends on what is in the bill. If, again, that bill is not bipartisan, they are just putting their own enforcement points, penalties and deportations, and just maybe a little bit of reliefs here and there. And that undoes the complete executive or relief plan that he has announced. Probably he's going to veto it. But if they can work out in some sense, make some sense, even if they don't agree with all the things, some of the things, work it out, make him agree, he's going to then sign it. But very difficult to predict.
Very difficult to predict. But the business immigration lawyers are very optimistic, of course. Having a Republican House and a Republican Senate means that they're going to focus on jobs and they're going to focus on highly skilled workers.
Correct.
So we're very optimistic about that. Michael, I see we're running very short on time. But I think we should just let our viewers know that we will be back, of course, with cutting edge news and letting them know, of course, what's happening in the immigration relief world.
Yeah, I think it's the right thing to do is to basically we both are waiting, watching, listening, reading, And as soon as we get any information that is extremely important, we leave everything on the side, come right in the studio, and you will be the first ones to know that.
Exactly. And if you have particular questions, of course, we do encourage you to send them to us by email. Our email address is on the screen. You can send it to info@visaserve.com or to myself or to Michael. We'll be more than happy to address your questions, hopefully on one of our upcoming TV shows.
Thank you very much, and bye.
Bye now.